I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good that I can do. I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good that I can do. I cannot give all the love that the world needs, but the world needs all the love that I can give. I cannot give all the love that the world needs, but the world needs all the love that I can give. I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good I can do. I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good I can do. I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good I can do. I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good I can do. I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good that I can do. I cannot give all the love that the world needs right now, but the world needs all the love that I can give. Ooh, all the love I can give. Oh yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome to Unity Spiritual Center of Woodstock. It feels like
the ship is listing.
Well, maybe they're just so amazed by how amazing you look today.
It's probably what that is.
This could be the life jacket? No. No. Welcome to Unity Spiritual Center of Woodstock. My name is Reverend Marypatriece Wendt. I am privileged and honored to be the spiritual leader here, and
I'm Reverend Tom Wendt. I'm relatively sure I want to be here today. It's just good to see you all. And we missed you last week. We were engaging in one of our favorite activities. We were hiking at Devil's Lake, Wisconsin, enjoying the fall colors. Awesome. What a beautiful weekend.
Yeah, we had some downtime and it was very much appreciated. So let's go ahead and begin this day with prayer. Let's take a deep breath. Divine Spirit that decorates this world with all the beautiful colors of gold and coral and greens and reds and oranges. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for the harvest of beauty that is all around us, and the beauty that is within us as we recognize it and it unfolds and expands as we see it within us and in everything that we share together. Thank you for the harvest of abundant ideas and ways of living that bless our world and those that we share it with. Thank you for the gift of being in it. Finding that pile of beautiful colors of leaves and just sharing that moment with it. Seeing it for what it is, all the special details, the various colors and textures and the movement of it. Thank you for the breath that opens up the lungs to this body and empowers every cell of our beings to experience it all. Thank you for having these moments together. Let there be many more. Let it be so, and so it is. Amen.
Amen.
Let's begin with our five unity principles, the basis of all that we believe and do. Together, please.
There is only one presence and one power in the universe and in my life.
God, the good omnipotence.
The Christ Spirit lives within me. Thoughts held in mind produce after their kind.
I experience God's presence and power through prayer and meditation. I put my faith into action by demonstration. Unity is about living a life that is more spiritual than religious. It's not that we don't have moments of feeling that sacredness, but in moments that are here in the sanctuary and through the events and the activities that we do here. But it's about finding those sacred moments throughout our day, throughout our lives, in all of our relationships, in all of the ways that we show up. It's about knowing that there's nothing that has to be so, that has to be just this way, for it to be beautiful, for it to be something that we grow from, that we connect with, and we know that there's a higher power in all things. We are about being a community that allows each and every person to find that journey, that path that is their own, that expression that uniquely shows up as them. And to find that it's okay for that to be so. It doesn't have to look like everyone else's. And that this community supports each and every one of us in that unique expression. And we're grateful to have the space and place to make that happen. Thank you for being here. And at this time, I want to introduce the wonderful, beautiful expressions that make this service possible, both those that you see on camera and those you don't. So for the team that is not on camera, I would like to say a thank you and honor the Christ within you, Mr. Rich Prezioso, Mr. Joe Joswiak, and Mr. Ted Squires. And for the lovely human being that shows up on the camera for you with all the wonderful ways that she expresses her divine self, we have Miss Lori Gray Muligano.
Always changed in time. It was my life, and I would not be persuaded from walking down the hard way to getting what was mine. But oh, I wanna be remembered not for what I have, but for who I have become. Every path that you're on, as you move on through your life, learn to laugh when you're wrong and try to make it right. Walk in beauty, walk in grace. Make a difference in this place. Leave something growing everywhere you pass, like wildflowers in the grass. I try to spend a little time doing something I believe in. That's a freedom that money can't buy. I find peace of mind in being where I'm needed, giving from my heart. It doesn't cost much to be kind. And oh, the greatest souls are humble. They have been my teachers. I have met them everywhere. Every path that you're on, as you move on through your life, learn to laugh when you're wrong and try to make it right. Walk in beauty, walk in grace, make a difference in this place. Leave something growing everywhere you pass, like wildflowers in the grass. Every path that you're on, as you move on through your life, learn to laugh when you're wrong and try to make it right. Walk in beauty, walk in grace, make a difference in this place. Leave something growing everywhere you pass, like wildflowers in the grass. Flowers in the grass make a difference in this place. Walk in beauty, walk in grace. Flowers in the grass. So let's spend some reflective time together as we remember that we are always evolving. We are a work of heart. You are a work of heart, a brilliant light for all to see. Perfect in every part, heaven and earth in harmony. The beauty of your face reveals a life of grace. You are a work of heart, a masterpiece. We are a work of heart, a brilliant light for all to see. Perfect in every part, heaven and earth in harmony. The beauty of your face reveals a life of grace. We are a work of heart, a masterpiece. The beauty of your face reveals a life of grace. We are a work of heart, a masterpiece. We are a work of heart, a masterpiece.
And so, dear friends, we enter into this time of guided meditation, accompanied by the beautiful tones of the singing bowls. This is our time to relax. Many here will close their physical eyes, focus on something they appreciate within this beautiful room. This is your time. Your time to be fully at peace. Your time to be fully relaxed. And breathe. As we focus on our breath, we release our attention to other matters of life that at this moment in time can be released. Be fully aware of every inhale and exhale. Allow my voice to be a background drone of sound that allows your spirit to go where it will during your time of meditation. Relax, sweet child. Simply relax. Allow the peace that comes from within to fill your breath, your brain, and your body. I am peaceful. I am at peace. Breathe into that idea. Allow your body to relax into peace. Simply be here now in the relaxed state of peace. Oh, feels good. Our muscles are at peace as they relax and allow ourselves to be fully supported where we sit or stand. I surrender to peace. I feel the peace of those around me right now. I feel the peace of those near me, whether I am here in the sanctuary or watching online. peace. That's all there is. Peace. And so I see myself so peaceful throughout this day that that is what I see in all others who cross my path. Today I am a peaceful soul. And as we begin to bring our attention back to this time and this place, let us imagine ourselves seeing everybody, regardless of outward appearances, as a peaceful soul. And allow our heart to share the space with them. As we continue to come back to this time and place, we may want to wiggle our toes and wiggle our fingers and open our eyes and be grateful for the peace that we experience at this moment in time. And beyond. And so it is. Amen.
Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you this past week there were moments I wasn't feeling very peaceful. Mm-hmm. So it was nice to get back there. Mm-hmm. Last weekend was beautiful, actually, getting away and being in nature. I don't know if any of you are the same way. I just love being outside, and it's taking pictures, and I wanted to post them all on Facebook and say, yeah, Florida, you got nothing on us. This is where I would want to be every day. And then even just this weekend, we got a chance to spend a little bit of time. If you get an opportunity, go to Coral Woods. It's not far from here. It's stunning. Mm-hmm. It's at its peak. It's just gorgeous. Fall is my favorite time of year. You know, putting on those cozy sweaters and having the fake fire on the TV and cookies in the oven, or cakes, or pies, whatever it needs to be, I don't care. But just that smell throughout the house. Growing up, I lived on a property. Our house was on a property about 1.5 acres, and one of our jobs back then was in the fall time to rake the leaves. 1.5 acres worth of leaves. They were everywhere you could imagine them to be. It was an overwhelming experience, and it was like, we're never going to get this done. But of course, if you have 5 kids, it may not take as long. 6 kids, 7. If they can stand up and hold a rake, you got to help. If you could bend over and pick up a leaf, you got to help. We had a lot of happy, leafy trees on the property, too, but not as many smiling kids when it came time to rake. And all of those leaves needed to somehow make it into 2 piles on the property so they could be burned. Because, you know, back then it was okay to burn your leaves. And so before we got to the burning place, we had this moment of heaven where we got to jump into them. into this huge pile of leaves, and you get buried underneath, like you can't see the sky because there's so many above you. And I remember just laying there and just taking as long as I could before I had to get out, and just smelling this sweet, spicy, earthy scent. You remember that? And how it just, it was like a potpourri of the season. But to get there, we lived on this 1.5 acre property, and I loved it because we ran. Everybody had 1.5 acres around us. We not only ran our own, but we ran others too. But in the springtime, we would plant a garden, a small one. My dad wasn't much for gardening, and I remember quite clearly, he was a very fair-skinned man, and he'd be out with the rototiller bouncing around, and his face would be beet red and sweaty, and he would have the most unpleasant look on his face, and my mom would be behind him with the biggest grin, and she could just stand in the sun for 15 minutes, and she'd turn as brown as a bear. And she'd be like, come on over. And she'd drop in, you get to drop in a seed here. I'll poke a hole, you drop in 3 seeds, I'll poke the next one. And someone else got to stand behind them and step on it so it would bury them. And all the rows were just so, and she'd have this string with the line and the little posts at the end so you knew where the row was and you didn't mess with it. And it was also to help you later on when things started growing so you'd know what was supposed to be there. She would just grin and glow because she loved having her bare feet in the dirt. And we grew up that way. We grew up mostly barefooted. It wasn't the best soil, but there was a nice, rich smell to it again, and even now when I pass by a farmer's field, I love to open the window and smell the fields when they're tilling in the springtime. Most of the time, we would plant tomatoes or cucumbers or green beans, maybe some onions, things. No. Once in a while, we try to plant carrots, but those didn't ever seem to come up very well. And some years were good, and other ones not so good. But I can tell you, every single year, there was an abundant crop of weeds. Abundant. Couldn't keep them from coming in. Seasons in biblical times were not spring, summer, fall, and winter. What would it have looked like if Jesus were alive today sitting under a sugar maple? How cool would that be, right? But that's not the type of environment that they had going on then. So they really pretty much had 2 seasons. One was summer, warm or hot, sunny, dry, and the other was winter, which is colder and rainy. And they would run from May through September, and then October through April. But the Jewish people divided that year up still into 4 seasons for planting what they could grow during a certain time frame. So for instance, in January was the coldest month and it was mostly raining and oftentimes flooding, not the biggest planting time. But in April, they would plant barley and wheat. In July, they harvested grapes and figs and olives. In October, they would harvest that barley and wheat. More on harvesting later.
In an earlier issue of Unity Magazine, international speaker and bioenergetic medicine practitioner Sue Mortar says, it may surprise you to know that your internal environment creates everything you experience in your external world. Your reality and life experiences are not fixed happenings. Rather, your reality is something we all create from within. So we're all experiencing this service differently because we're all creating it from within ourselves. See, she teaches that life is like a movie, one where we are writing the script, setting the scene, determining the lines of the actors and how we interpret them. We star in it, we direct it, and we project the images of it on our screen that we call our life. And it's different for each and every one of us. So to witness the beautiful movie that we desire to be our lives, we must first create it within. I'm thinking of Gandhi, right, when I say that. Be the change you wish to see. I'll share with you that within a month's time, I have seen two vivid examples where a group of individuals created a movie of their life that they so desired. One of happiness, commitment, and excitement. And they were both associated with this ministry, Unity Spiritual Center of Woodstock. The first, I'm talking about within a month's time now, was the first World Day of Peace celebration that you initiated and included about 20-some volunteers. I witnessed the volunteers from this ministry, like I say, 20 or so, hauling equipment from this building over to the town square. And those who aren't familiar with Woodstock, that's a, what, three-block walk or something like that. They were bringing the equipment to facilitate the celebration, to accommodate the vendors that were to be there and the anticipated audience. A lot of work. It was kind of a rainy day, too. And you know what? Nobody complained about anything. There was no whining or mumbling or, as the Bible would say, tearing of clothes or gnashing of teeth. Everybody was happy. Everybody was committed and really working at it. Everyone pitching in from concept to closure. The movies running in our volunteers' lives during that event were happy movies. Movies full of excitement and results and commitment. It was so obvious our volunteers were glad to be there and happy to serve. They were harvesting the joy one receives from committed volunteering. The second notable event is the craft fair that started here yesterday from about 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. and continues today after the service right there in the fellowship area until about 5 or so this evening. Volunteers, you know, creating cookies and brownies and those Rice Krispie squares that I just love, muffins and cupcakes and more. And then going back in time, you had the volunteers planning it all, organizing it all, contacting the vendors, doing the marketing, thinking about setting up. The craft fair is a fundraiser for this church. Everyone you see working there is a volunteer. And the excitement and energy of those volunteers is palpable. It is really cool out there. There's a belief going on in our culture that volunteers are getting harder and harder to find. Here's what I've learned. It's not difficult to find volunteers. The task is find something people want to volunteer for and that they can stand behind and become energized about. There's a big difference. Friday evening during setup, Karen Peterson, who's sitting back there, was telling me, you know, there's vendors downstairs too. I said, well, let's go down and show me what's down there. Let's see what's going on. She brought me down there, was so excited about all the creativity that is so obvious down there in each of these vendors, different focuses and different abilities. Then coming upstairs, witnessing the pumpkins for the pumpkin auction that we hold every year. This year, you can bid on the pumpkins right here at the craft fair. All a fundraiser for our church. And everyone serving this very worthwhile activity was just dripping with excitement and commitment around all of it. There were so many happy movies playing yesterday, you could have shown it on an IMAX screen to catch it all. It was just huge. And yet, please realize, these are just common activities, really. Happen all over, nothing special about them. But they're made incredibly special by the commitment and the excitement and the energy of the volunteers engaging in them. These volunteers, all of you that we're so grateful for, it was so obvious you believed in what you're doing out there. So thank you for that. And as I said earlier, your reality does not just happen to you, it happens through you. Our reality happens because of us, not in spite of us. You want your life to get better? You want to show a happy movie? Become involved in something you believe in. Never mind the excuses that you're too busy or any other reasons that we can give. Get committed to and busy with a more meaningful and diverse life. More in a moment.
I would also add to that, it doesn't just happen to you. All that you are experiencing and emanating happens to everyone around you.
Yeah.
It just brings it up a level. You could just feel the excitement in the building yesterday and will continue today for sure.
It's contagious, isn't it?
It is contagious. Yeah, I stopped by yesterday and I'm like, wait, I want to stay here, but I got to go home and get ready for this talk. What am I going to do? So I ended up, I had to cut it short, but I spent 3 hours here yesterday. It was pretty cool. Matthew chapter 13, verse 24 to 30 says, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, sir, you didn't sow good seed in your field. Where then did the, if you did, why are there weeds there? And he replied, an enemy did this. The servants asked him, do you want us to go and pull them up? And he said, no, because while you're pulling the weeds, you may root up the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at that time, I will tell the harvesters. First, collect the weeds and tie them into bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it to my barn. Matthew goes on to say in verse 37, the one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. And the good seed stands for the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are the angels. Many of you know that I make regular or semi-regular trips to see my son and his wife and my new grandson. We drive up and try to support and enjoy them as much as we can. Those moments are priceless. They're pure seeds of happiness and wonder and sharing and connecting. I'm planting these seeds. We're planting these seeds with this new family. And we're watching them make choices, conscious choices as parents of who they want to be, and watching this little baby thrive in that. I couldn't be happier to be part of it. And I want to plant as many of those good seeds as I can. And the garden has been growing and the connection has been unfolding and I'm just so excited about it. And then there was that day. There was a day. I don't know, was it a word or an action or something that was like, wait a minute, what's happening here? I'm not feeling as connected. Something's going on. Did you hear so-and-so say this? Did you see so-and-so do that? Wait a minute, were they going to really let me hold him or not? Wait a minute. But it started the question, a doubt, a wondering, wait a minute, is this as amazing as I've been thinking about it this whole time? Is there something else going on? You know, are they really excited about us coming to visit? A weed showing up in my garden of good. And it began to multiply. Over the next couple of visits, I was like, wait a minute, you know, I started looking for something happening that wasn't resonating with this beautiful picture that I had. And of course, you know, whenever you look for something, you're going to find it. So more doubts started coming up, more interpreting words and action in ways that weren't in alignment with that growing garden that I first planted. And it started feeling a little crowded. The good was still there, but it's starting to be overshadowed by some of these thoughts going on in my head. When the weeds start overriding the relationships in my life, one of the things that I tend to do is I start to withdraw. Do you ever do that? You start to get quiet and pull back a little bit, and you watch more. I was beginning to do that, and that was my signal. Wait a minute, it's time for a harvest. There was one day it came up, and I turned to Tom, and I said, you know, I really don't like the way that I'm thinking. I really don't like what's happening inside of me. I need to call and have a conversation. I need to talk this out. I need to find out more information. Is what the junk going on in my head, is that really true? Or am I just creating weeds? I would love to say somebody else is, because that's what I, you know, when I'm watching to say, wait a minute, that's what they did there, or that's what they said there. It's like I can give somebody else the responsibility for what's happening in here. So I said, we need to call. We need not just a call, we need to have a Zoom. Zoom is amazing, you know? So on the day of harvest, when we were getting ready to make that call, I'm sitting down with Tom and I said, my stomach's upset. I'm feeling, I'm not looking forward to this. Oh, let's say a prayer. Would you pray with me, please? I really want this to go well. I know I'm going to have to really show up and show what's going on inside of me. And then we made the call. And I sat down and I said, you know, I have some wonderings I need to talk with you about. I'm wondering about a few things, and I know that there's a lot of junk going on. There's a lot of weeds growing in my brain around it, and I need your help in clearing them. I admitted to all of the weeds and the topics that I needed their help to separate from the seeds, the growing plants, the truth. I covered every single topic that was on my mind, and I was having, and all the things that I had doubts about, and I owned my stuff around it. I shared what I heard and how I interpreted it. And then I sat and was prepared for the worst to come as a response. And it was like, you know, that moment where you just like, you hold your breath waiting to hear what's going to come back to you. In the revealing word written by Charles Fillmore, one of our co-founders, you know, we look at things, we look at the Bible and even at our lives as a metaphysical story of what's going on and how we can work through it. And he talks about, there are words in there that he will define for you from the Bible metaphysically. So like evil and enemy is really just something that is not generated from God, something that is not coming from a higher source. Well, I could admit to that, that's for sure. I really wanted to believe that someone or something else was interfering. It would be so much easier. But an angel in the stories, in the Bible, represent a projection of a spiritual idea into your consciousness. What was my idea? Let's have that Zoom call. And the outcome was a very candid conversation between all of us. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just my conversation about setting me straight, because that's what I expected, because I knew I needed to be set straight, but it was an incredibly candid conversation about everyone's perspective. And the decision of what steps we need to make to keep the good garden growing from that point on. I had basically raked up my pile of issues. I didn't say shoveled up my pile of issues. I had basically raked up my pile of issues with the most important people in my life that were involved in that. And you know, we, not just me, but we all jumped in. And it was really sweet. Now that is a harvest, very ripe for harvesting.
Yeah, you pulled some weeds first, we all did. And then we enjoyed the harvest of a heartfelt, candid family conversation. Very moving, for sure. In the Gospel of John, Jesus is purported to have said, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." And then he added, "Do you not say 4 months from now and then the harvest?" He goes on to say, I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. The volunteers I spoke of earlier are harvesting the fruits of their commitment, their involvement, and their energy. The movies of happiness that is their life are the result of their imaginations coming to fruition by means of their engagement, their involvement, and their service. In his book, The Art of Being, author Dennis Merritt Jones says, throughout the millennia, enlightenment has been touted as the brass ring on the spiritual path. Enlightenment. That's what we're seeking, is enlightenment. It's the highest accomplishment in our minds a soul could ever obtain while here, we're all here in Earth school. And yet masters from almost every tradition have said the same thing regarding enlightenment. Nothing changes in enlightenment except one's perception. And with a shift in perception comes a new experience of reality and life. With enlightenment comes a new way of seeing things. That's all. Because after enlightenment, we still have to go to work, do the dishes, mow the lawn, live with our family and our neighbors.
Rake the leaves.
Rake the leaves, honor our bodies. We simply do it with a new sense of perception, a new sense of being connected to the divine flow of life. Enlightenment is just a realization, that's all. The harvest Jesus spoke of is that new perspective of life, available to all of us following enlightenment, and the fields are ripe right now. After enlightenment comes living life fully, volunteering, serving as you're with all your might, unconditionally giving back to your sources in every way we can. Just as our World Day of Peace and Craft Fair volunteers have so clearly done. You know, these days, in fact, as we were driving to our destinations last week and this week, you see farmers out in the field with these huge machines harvesting the seeds they have planted and the work they have done. We don't need big machines to enjoy the harvest that Jesus spoke of. All we need to do is get off the couch, turn off the TV, turn on our imagination, and create the movie we want by becoming fully engaged in life. That's all. Volunteering, serving, working with teams, being involved with people. Doing something we've never done before. Rewrite your life script through involvement and action. Never mind the weeds that MP alluded to earlier that we can create in our minds and fertilize with all of our stories about what they did. Never mind those. Become enlightened through a new perspective. Remember, your internal environment creates everything you experience in the external world. What's going on in here creates all this and our experience of it. To witness the beautiful movie we desire to see on the outside of our life, first we create it where? Within, inside. Right? So lastly, I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields, man. They are ripe for harvest right now. I urge you to get involved.
In closing, harvesting is the best time of the year. It's where you get rid of the stuff that doesn't work for you and you focus on the things that the rewards of getting to where you are. A spiritual harvest is that inner work which leads to outer demonstrations of joy. In both situations considered here, they foster an enlightened life. Let's pray. Let's take a deep breath. Divine Spirit in me, I draw upon the awareness of your unending presence, support, and inspiration within at all times to harvest a life that expresses unlimited abundance and joy. Let it be so, and so it is. Namaste.
And I'm going to share a song that is an oldie but a goodie, and Ted's going to put the words of the chorus, so please feel free to join me on it. Just try.
Take a little time out of your busy day to give encouragement to someone who's lost the way. Or would I be talking to a stone if I asked you to share a problem that's not your own? We can change things if we start giving. Why don't you reach out and touch somebody's hand? Make this world a better place if you can. Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place if you can. Just try. If you see an old friend on the street and he's down, remember his shoes could fit your feet. Truly, we can change things if we start giving. Why don't you reach out and touch somebody's hand? Make this world a better place if you can.
Reach out and touch
somebody's hand.
Reach out and touch
somebody's hand.
Make this world
a better place.
If you can, one more time. Reach out and
touch
somebody's
hand.
Make this world a better place.
If you can,
make this world a better place.
Yes,
you can. Make this world a better place.
Yes, you can.
Wow. You just want to smell that sweet aroma of the leaves that are falling down and just take in the moment. All right. Now we're going to transition into that time of our service where we welcome and gratefully accept your gifts, your tithes, your offerings, whatever that might look like. If you are online enjoying this service, please go to our Joy of Giving tab and click on there. Wherever you may be, just hold your gift in your hand. This is the harvest of all that you have done so far. Not to say it's going to be anything but more in the future. But know that, accept that, and bless it as the gift that everything in you that has brought you to this moment to give this gift has been a gift of its own. So we see this harvest of gifts and offerings as the blessing forward to all the programs and the classes that go on here, the events that we do to reach out to the community, and all the ways that we are here to support one another. Let's finish out with a short prayer. Divine love, flowing through me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Amen.
Thank you.
for all the gifts that are here that have been shared online. We say thank you, God, three times, and thank you to each and every giver. Together, please. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Amen. Right. We have a couple of announcements today. Unity Spiritual Center of Woodstock is a ministry based in prayer. So if you would like a joy or a concern to be held in prayer for the next 30 days, you can pop a little note into our prayer box over here. And is Jackie in the house ready to pray? Thank you very much. Jackie can help you out. She's our prayer chaplain in person, one-on-one, confidentially. She will meet with you right after the service. We also have candles at the end of the aisle if you'd like to remember someone or an event. You can purchase a candle for just $2, and we will light it each week that we are here until they burn out. And our announcements. So we have some classes and groups that are meeting. Please check out our website for more information. You'll see some of them here. Also, our lending library. May not be the best day today to visit because of our craft fair, but please make a plan to go there. There's so many resources. We also have the Living Untethered study group going on each Wednesday evening. Feel free to check that out, and the costs are online, I believe. Also, next week we have the Sue Battis Memorial Luncheon after, it's a potluck after the service. Please stop in. If you are providing a dish, please let Lori know. In addition, right today is the last day of our craft fair. And because you are here in the building, what we'll need you to do to go is don't go through these doors. Go back out here. Get a, I think they're pink slips from the greeter. Oh, Eileen's got them in the back. Get a pink slip. This will get you free admission into the craft fair. If you'd like to register for a door prize, they're in the greeting center. They're $5 to put your name in for that. There's also a wonderful raffle. And also, be sure to check out our pumpkin auction. It's a silent auction this year. The creativity is no less than any other year. It gets better and better. So please be sure to be part of that. Also, we're not going to do our kindness rocks today because you can't get to them. There are about 24 vendors today upstairs in fellowship and downstairs. So be sure to check it all out. It's awesome. And I'm going to be going there as well right afterwards. I hope I'll get my pink slip on my way out. So we are planning our Christmas tree walk, and I am calling all men in our ministry to meet. I would like you all to get together with me so that we can talk about creating a men's group for Unity. And I'm not leading it. I'm just going to help facilitate your ideas. So let's do that. I will send out an e-blast this week. You can talk to me and say, hey, I'm interested. I want to be part of this because we want you to get together and have some fun just like our ladies group does. So also, last thing, email solicitations. This is that wonderful time of year where people are looking to sell or maybe just get money in any way that they can. If you receive an email from me that looks like my name, I know there's a Gmail account on there that says Rev. Mary Patrice Wendt on it. It is not mine. I do not have it. But oftentimes what they are going to do is ask you to buy gift cards or something, send them money in some way. If there's something I need from you, I will talk with you personally or I will call you. So please don't fall for that. It happens every year. Our last group of things is openings. We took one off the list. We have our hospitality leader, Fabulous. Any other opportunities that you are ready to jump in, give us a hand with, please let me know. We would love to have you. And I think that is everything. Did I cover everything, Joe? Got it. Good. Okay, let's go ahead and stand for our prayer for protection and our closing peace song. Remember, you'll be going out the back doors, get your pink slip from Chris or Eileen, and head on over to the craft fair. It's amazing. Ready? Together, please. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. And so it is.
All the good.